Hello, it's your friendly neighborhood host JT Wheatley back again for another episode of the History Comics Podcast. This time with another edition of the classics, with a Camelot 3000 by Mike W. Barr and Brian Bolland, which is a now classic, what is called a maxi-series, which is a 12-issue mini-series that was published by DC running from 1982 to 1985 that takes place in the year 3000, in which during an alien invasion, the classic Arthurian King Arthur and his Arthurian knights are reincarnated to help fight them off, and sure enough, their old enemy Morgan Le Fay is involved as well. It's a great mixing between the medieval tales and the sci-fi sorcery and something and so forth, along with mixing the interesting twists and turns, because the reincarnations come a little different. For instance, Tristan, when King Arthur's knight, is reincarnated as a woman, and that brings up some interesting gender issues and sexuality politics and so forth. But of course, also all the classic twists that are there as well, such as King Arthur, Guinevere, and Lancelot and their classic love triangle, and of course, his relationship with his half-sister Morgana, and so forth. And it has some wonderful art by Brian Bolland, who, of course, would go on to the Killing Joke fame and forth, so forth like that. But unfortunately, he was such a perfectionist with his art style that he would draw it so detailed because he was afraid of having another inker ink over his work and alter things. He made it where they left no room to where they can change anything. But it resulted in, as it's been commented on, it took him 9 months to draw the final issue. As pointed out, this is a maxi series, which is 12 issues, and it took 3 years to finally come out. And it should be pointed out, this is Camelot 3000, on top of being a great story and a classic story, is also a pretty significant comic book because it was one of the first books that DC made just for the new direct market, i.e., they sold it straight to comic book stores as opposed to like newsstands and digital distributors. And plus, a maxi series is being one of the first ones, because originally DC also innovated what's called a limited series, which is typically a limited series, and the comic book is like a series that lasts for like 6 or less issues. A maxi series goes for like 6 or more. It's about the unofficial rule of that. And DC, back in the late 70s, did the first limited series of World of Krypton. And this was the first maxi series. And it showed that during the 80s, comic books with the direct market especially were starting to experiment with not only the kind of storytelling to be told, but how you could tell it. Like, let's do 12 issues series, and that's it. No sequels, no ongoing, and just have one complete story. And a nice advantage of that, especially today, because you can get Camelot 3000 for a fairly good price in most comic book stores or retailers. And you don't have to worry about those late issues anymore, because it's all collected all in one great read. It's a great, solid read, so wherever you can get it, it's definitely worth picking up. And it's a great, like I said, because it was sold to the direct market to go outside the code as well. So it deals with some pretty heady subjects for the early 80s, such as, like I said, with homosexuality, gender issues, and so forth like that. So, yeah. But also, it's a great sci-fi action mixed with Arthurian sorcery. So, yeah, great read regardless. So, yeah, you're looking for another good read? When you go to your comic store, check out Camelot 3000, because that is a true classic. And now is January 28th, 2021, time for the favorite comic of the week. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, The Last Ronin, number 1, by Kevin Eastman, Peter Laird, along with additional help from artists like Tom Waltz, which is almost a Dark Knight Return-style story that finds the last surviving Ninja Turtle journeying to a futuristic New York City to take down the Shredder's grandson, Hiroto, who has somehow taken over. But things don't go as planned, and of course, this Ninja Turtle finds himself meeting up some old friends and allies he wasn't expecting. This is a great return to the gritty roots of the original Ninja Turtles, and of course, not helped in large part by Laird and Eastman returning to their original creation. And I love the story, too, because this turtle makes his move to New York City. You're never really given a hint, like, okay, which one is it, and why is he hearing the voices of the other turtles in his head, and what happened to him? So it sets a great mystery up, what happened to the other turtles, and also how is Hiroto has taken over New York City, and we run some other characters. For Turtles fans, this is like a lot of fun. And you love how this last Ronin turtle operates, because even though he's just one, he's using all of his brother's different weapons. The nunchucks, the bow staff, the katana, the size, everything. Also, playing up the fact that you're not really sure which turtle this is. It does get revealed at the very last panel, and it's heartbreaking and how they do it. But yeah, I actually missed this on first printing. I told myself I should probably get this up. I've been hearing good things, but thankfully a second printing just came out, and it's a really great read. So if you can catch your comic book store, definitely pick it up. It's a little pricier, but it looks like it's going to be well worth it, and it has potential to become like the Ninja Turtles Dark Knight Returns kind of story. And with that, that will conclude this edition of Classics for this week. Join me again next week when I'll probably be doing another edition of the Classics. And until then, go out and get yourself a good comic book. And if you can, pick up a Camelot 3000. That is a true classic.